Did you ever wonder why, for millions of people around the world, Christmas is associated with images like this? Or this? Or this?
Was born on Christmas Day to save us all.
Or this? Despite the fact that the actual birthplace of Jesus looks like this. You also notice that although those images seem to be very specifically Christmas images, none of them contain any explicitly Christian iconography. There are no religious symbols appearing in any of them. So what links them with Christmas? Why are Christmas images so often associated with Victorian England rather than the actual Holy Land? Another important question is, despite the fact that Christmas is explicitly a Christian holiday and celebrates an important date in Christian history and celebrated in countries that are predominantly Christian, why is the celebration so deeply connected with items that are not religious in nature? Why did Saint Nicholas become Santa Claus and Santa Claus become an important icon for Christmas, even though Santa Claus himself, as we are familiar with him now, was invented by Coca-Cola? That's true, by the way, that the original Santa Claus, the original image of Saint Nicholas, is usually wearing a long green coat with ermine lining and not wearing a red, white, and black coat, which are the colors of Coca-Cola. And it isn't celebrated just in the central weeks of December. For most of its history, Christmas was celebrated only on Christmas Day. It wasn't even actually that big a holiday. Not much more, in fact, than All Hallows' Eve. Easter was traditionally a much more important holiday within the Christian tradition. But now, retailers are establishing their Christmas displays in mid-October, almost before the Halloween displays come down. Christmas decorations are up at the big box hardware stores and Target and Walmart. So why did Christmas become such a popular secular holiday and not just a religious holiday that's celebrated for what is now almost 2 months of the year? And the answer is, of course, the man who invented Christmas, Charles Dickens. Now, I know that sounds absurd that someone who was born in 1812 could have invented a holiday that was officially born in the year 336. But Christmas wasn't celebrated the way we celebrate it now for most of its history. And even in Victorian England, it wasn't celebrated the way we celebrate it now until the latter half of the 19th century, which is why we have the images that we have so often associating Christmas with Victorian England. Because the secular holiday we have now was introduced in the form that we have it by a convergence of traditions, some of which are directly traceable to Charles Dickens. And that's why when you see Christmas carolers, they're dressed in Victorian clothing, and when they set up Christmas scenes, they have pine trees and snow as opposed to desert scenes. So we're going to be looking at Dickens' novel, A Christmas Carol, and talking about the ways that Christmas was shaped by the consciousness, by the ideology that appears within that text, and by other texts as well. In fact, Christmas stories, ranging from longer stories to short stories, became a Dickens tradition after The Christmas Carol, and he has several other Christmas stories which were published afterwards, including A Haunted Man, The Cricket on the Hearth, and a few other stories which celebrate Christmas themes. In A Christmas Carol, we have the story of the reform of a utilitarian villain, a man who Dickens believes represents the worst of utilitarian philosophy. So it starts off with stave one. A stave, for those of you who are familiar with musical notation, is an older English term for a staff. And a staff is the five-line musical notation on which one records notes in order to write down music. And by the way, Dickens made a tremendous amount of money, both for himself and for charitable causes, by doing dramatic readings of his works. And one of his most popular dramatic readings was A Christmas Carol. And he would stand on stage and not just read it, but actually enact the various characters, becoming a crabbed old man with a cracked voice for Scrooge and a hearty young man for Fred, etc. So this is a text that lends itself very well to performance. Now obviously we don't have time to look at every single element within this text, so we're going to focus on those elements which relate specifically to Dickens' characterization of utilitarianism and his alternative philosophy, and look at the way that Dickens, though he is attacking utilitarianism, ultimately embodies a utilitarian philosophy as we saw described in John Stuart Mill's essay, Utilitarianism. Marley was dead, to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. Scrooge signed it, and Scrooge's name was good upon change for anything he chose to put his hand to. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. Mind, I don't mean to say that I know of my own knowledge what there is particularly dead about a doornail. I might have been inclined myself to regard a coffin nail as the deadest piece of ironmongery in the trade. But the wisdom of our ancestors is in the simile, and my unhallowed hands shall not disturb it, or the country's done for. You will therefore permit me to repeat emphatically that Marley was dead as a doornail. Scrooge knew he was dead? Of course he did. How could it be otherwise? Scrooge and he were partners for I don't know how many years. Scrooge was his sole executor, his sole administrator, his sole assign, his sole residuary legatee, his sole friend, and sole mourner. And even Scrooge was not so dreadfully cut up by the sad event but that he was an excellent man of business on the very day of the funeral and solemnized it with an undoubted bargain. The mention of Marley's funeral brings me back to the point I started from. There is no doubt that Marley was dead. This must be distinctly understood, or nothing wonderful can come of the story I'm going to relate. If we were not perfectly convinced that Hamlet's father died before the play began, there would be nothing more remarkable in his taking a stroll at night and an easterly wind upon his own ramparts than there would be in any other middle-aged gentleman rashly turning out after dark in a breezy spot, say St. Paul's Churchyard, for instance, literally to astonish his son's weak mind. Now, I want to point out a couple of things about this as the opening of a novel. First, one should always pay attention to the opening of the novel, because the opening of a novel serves the same function that the establishing shot serves in cinema. The establishing shot in cinema is the first image that you see that is relevant to the movie itself. And it establishes you within the place of the world and the tone of the world and the atmosphere of the movie. So in this particular case, we have a very sort of chatty narrator starting to tell us a story in a very storytelling kind of mode, as though we were sitting around a fire and he was telling us a story while we drank hot buttered rum or cocoa. The second thing is that he's kind of funny. He's starting off by making sure that we understand that Marley was dead, because if he wasn't dead, there wouldn't be anything very surprising about him showing up in Scrooge's parlor. Now he's going to go on and start to establish the characters. And so the first character he's going to establish, obviously, is Scrooge, his protagonist, and at this point, the villain. Scrooge never painted out old Marley's name. There it stood, years afterwards, above the warehouse door. Scrooge and Marley. The firm was known as Scrooge and Marley. Sometimes people new to the business called Scrooge Scrooge, and sometimes Marley. But he answered to both names. It was all the same to him. Obviously, Scrooge doesn't care about forming personal bonds with his customers, because as far as he's concerned, as far as they're concerned, he's just the business, and the business is Scrooge and Marley. He has no personal connection with them, which then goes on to tell us about Scrooge's character. Oh, but he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone, Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. Hard and sharp as flint, from which no steel had ever struck out generous fire. Secret and self-contained, and solitary as an oyster. The cold within him froze his old features, nipped his pointed nose, shriveled his cheek, stiffened his gait, made his eyes red, his thin lips blue, and spoke out shrewdly in his grating voice. A frosty rime was on his head and on his eyebrows and his wiry chin. He carried his own low temperature always about him. He iced his office in the dog days and didn't thaw it 1 degree at Christmas. And so Scrooge is characterized here as being associated with cold. He's hard, but he's also especially cold. No steel had ever struck out generous fire. Steel, of course, would be the steel that you use to strike sparks to start a fire. He's secret, self-contained, and solitary. So he's cold and lonely. The cold within him froze his old features, nipped his pointed nose, turned his thin lips blue. A frosty rime was on his head and on his eyebrows. He carried his own low temperature always about with him. He iced his office in the dog days and didn't thaw it 1 degree at Christmas. And so, with what is the idea of cold associated in Dickens? Well, he will make it quite clear if we continue looking at this narrative. External heat and cold had little influence on Scrooge. No warmth could warm, nor wintry chill him. No wind that blew was bitterer than he. No falling snow was more intent upon its purpose. No pelting rain less open to entreaty. Foul weather didn't know where to have him. The heaviest rain and snow and hail and sleet could boast of the advantage over him in only one respect. They often came down handsomely, and Scrooge never did. To come down means to be generous, to give someone a gift. And Scrooge never comes down handsomely. He never gives anyone a generous gift. Furthermore, Scrooge is isolated from all other humans. He doesn't engage in human sympathy. Nobody ever stopped him in the street to say with gladsome looks, "My dear Scrooge, how are you? When will you come to see me?" No beggars implored him to bestow a trifle. No children asked him what it was o'clock. No man or woman ever once in all his life inquired the way to such and such a place of Scrooge. Even the blind man's dogs appeared to know him, and when they saw him coming on, would tug their owners into doorways and up courts, and then would wag their tails as though they said, "No eye at all is better than an evil eye, dark master." But what did Scrooge care? It was the very thing he liked. To edge his way along the crowded paths of life, warning all human sympathy to keep its distance, was what the knowing ones call nuts to Scrooge. So Scrooge is associated with cold, and cold is associated with lack of sympathy and fellowship. Cold is also, by the way, associated with discomfort, and that becomes clear when we see the condition under which Scrooge's clerk, Bob Cratchit, must work. Scrooge had a very small fire, but the clerk's fire was so very much smaller that it looked like one coal. But he couldn't replenish it, for Scrooge kept the coal box in his own room, and so surely as the clerk came in with a shovel, the master predicted that it would be necessary for them to part. Wherefore the clerk put on his white comforter and tried to warm himself at the candle, in which effort, not being a man of strong imagination, he failed. Now into this room, into this cold room of discomfort and unfriendliness, comes the antithesis of Scrooge, who is his nephew Fred Vincey. Fred Vincey walks in, literally bursts into the office. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle! God save you!" cried a cheerful voice. It was the voice of Scrooge's nephew, who came upon him so quickly that this was the first intimation he had of his approach. And now come two of the most famous words in Christmas literature. Said Scrooge. "Humbug!" He had so heated himself with rapid walking in the fog and frost, this nephew of Scrooge's, that he was all in a glow. His face was ruddy and handsome, his eyes sparkled, and his breath smoked again. So, clearly, as opposed to Scrooge, who is icy and frosty, Fred is heated. His face is in a glow. It's ruddy and handsome. His eyes sparkled as though there are sparks coming from them, and his breath smoked. So he's associated with warmth. "Christmas a humbug, Uncle," said Scrooge's nephew. "You don't mean that, I'm sure."
"I do," said Scrooge. "Merry Christmas? What right have you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry? You're poor enough." "Come then," returned the nephew gaily. "What right have you to be dismal? What reason have you to be morose? You're rich enough." Scrooge, having no better answer ready on the spur of the moment, said, "Pah!" again, and followed it up with, "Humbug!" "Don't be cross, Uncle," said the nephew. "What else can I be," returned the uncle, "when I live in such a world of fools as this? Merry Christmas? Out upon Merry Christmas! What's Christmas time to you but a time for paying bills without money? A time for finding yourself a year older and not an hour richer? A time for balancing your books and having every item in them through a round dozen of months presented dead against you." "If I could work my will," said Scrooge indignantly, "every idiot who gave about with Merry Christmas on his lips should be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart, he should." So clearly, they have very opposite attitudes towards Christmas. Scrooge sees Christmas as a waste of time and money, something that never put a scrap of money in his pocket, as he says. Where on the other hand, the nephew sees it as an opportunity to celebrate fellowship. And if we go on down, we get Fred's philosophy of Christmas spelled out. There are many things from which I might have derived good, by which I have not profited, I dare say, returned the nephew, Christmas among the rest. But I am sure I have always thought of Christmas time when it has come around, apart from the veneration due to its sacred name and origin, if anything belonging to it can be apart from that, as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable, pleasant time. The only time I know in the long calendar of the year where men and women seem by one consent to open their shut-up hearts freely and to think of people below them as if they really were fellow passengers to the grave and not another race of creatures bound on other journeys. And therefore, Uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe that it has done me good and will do me good. And I say, God bless it. I want to call your attention to the fact that in this whole novel, this is the only reference to the religious aspect of Christmas. This novel celebrates Christmas in a very secular way, celebrating it as an opportunity for secular fellowship as opposed to Christian worship. So we have now the main opposition in this novel set up between Scrooge as the cold, unsympathetic, greedy miser, and Fred is the open, young, warm-hearted, friendly gentleman. On the next page, to make Scrooge's representation of utilitarian doctrine clear, Dickens has Scrooge visited by two gentlemen who are collecting pledges for the poor. They're going around to businesses and asking businessmen to pledge to give a certain amount of money to help the poor. At the time, they called them subscriptions. And so these two people come in and ask Scrooge to give a subscription to help provide food for the poor at Christmas time. "Scrooge and Marley's, I believe," said one of the gentlemen, referring to this list. "Have I the pleasure of addressing Mr. Scrooge or Mr. Marley?" "Mr. Marley has been dead these 7 years," Scrooge replied. "He died 7 years ago this very night." "We have no doubt his liberality is well represented by his surviving partner," said the gentleman presenting his credentials. It certainly was, for they had been two kindred spirits. At the ominous word liberality, Scrooge frowned and shook his head and handed the credentials back. "At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge," said the gentleman, taking up a pen, "it is more than usually desirable that we should make some slight provision for the poor and destitute who suffer greatly at the present time. Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts." "Are there no prisons?" asked Scrooge. "Plenty of prisons," said the gentleman, laying down the pen again. "And the Union workhouses," demanded Scrooge. "Are they still in operation?" "They are still," returned the gentleman. "I wish I could say they were not." "The treadmill and the poor law, are they in full vigor then?" said Scrooge. "Both very busy, sir." "Oh, I was afraid from what you said at first that something had occurred to stop them in their useful course." So Scrooge is clearly the utilitarian villain here. He's making reference to the institutions established by the poor law in order to help the poor, by the new poor law, as we discussed in a previous video. And the advantage of these is that they're useful. They're utilitarian. "Under the impression that they scarcely furnish Christian cheer of mind or body to the multitude," returned the gentleman, "a few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and some means of warmth. We choose this time because it is a time of all others when want is keenly felt and abundance rejoices. What shall I put you down for?" "Nothing," said Scrooge. "You wish to be anonymous?" "I wish to be left alone," said Scrooge. "Since you ask me what I wish, gentlemen, that is my answer. I don't make merry myself at Christmas, and I can't afford to make idle people merry. I help to support the establishments I have mentioned. They cost enough, and those who are badly off must go there. Many can't go there, and many would rather die." "If they would rather die," said Scrooge, "they had better do it and decrease the surplus population." So Scrooge is expressing the idea popularized by economist Thomas Malthus that the poor are evidence of too many people, and that supporting these people through social welfare programs just prolongs poverty because the economy can't support them. And to the opponents of utilitarianism, this sounded like a cold and heartless philosophy.
And Scrooge is being the mouthpiece for this philosophy in this novel. So, after grudgingly giving Cratchit the next day off, Christmas Day, and even more grudgingly deciding he's not going to hold back pay for Cratchit's holiday, he heads home. Now, Scrooge lives in an old, large house, which has been converted into separate office suites, except that Marley, Scrooge's late partner, had kept rooms in there to live in. And so Scrooge lives alone in a big, dark, gloomy house. But, and this is one of my favorite lines in the novel because it reveals Scrooge's character so completely, Scrooge doesn't care about the fact that it's large and gloomy. It says, up Scrooge went, not caring a button for that. Darkness is cheap. And Scrooge liked it. So he goes into his room, locks the doors, checks under the bed, makes sure nothing dangerous is hiding somewhere. And then the supernatural begins to impose itself. The first sign that something supernatural was happening was Marley's head mysteriously appearing in place of the knocker on the door of the house, but Scrooge had dismissed that. And now, in his room, he's looking at a bell that is connected by a rope to another part of the house. They're service bells. If you've ever watched Downton Abbey, they have ropes running through the walls with bells connected to springs in the servants' parlor. And you can pull a rope in a room and it will ring the bell and the servant knows they're needed so that they can go answer the bell. That's actually where the term answering the bell came from. There is an old disused bell in Scrooge's room. And the bells begin slowly and then suddenly and violently to swing, as do all of the other bells in the house. And then he hears a door below slam open, and then chains being dragged across the floor down below. And then Marley's ghost comes through the locked door. The same face, the very same. Marley in his pigtail, usual waistcoat, tights and boots, tassels in the latter bristling like his pigtail, and his coat skirts and the hair upon his head. The chain he drew was clasped about his middle. It was long and wound about him like a tail. And it was made, for Scrooge observed it closely, of cash boxes, keys, padlocks, ledgers, deeds, and heavy purses wrought in steel. His body was transparent, so that Scrooge, observing him and looking through his waistcoat, could see the two buttons on his coat behind. Scrooge had often heard it said that Marley had no bowels, but he had never believed it until now. And so Marley comes to grudgingly warn Scrooge about his fate, which is going to be, if he doesn't change, the same as Marley's has been. And the reason that Scrooge is bound by the same sort of chains that bind Marley is that, like Marley, Scrooge has not fulfilled his human obligations. The ghost tells Scrooge, "It is required of every man," the ghost returned, "that the spirit within him should walk abroad among his fellow men and travel far and wide. And if that spirit goes not forth in life, it is condemned to do so after death. It is doomed to wander through the world, oh, woe is me, and witness what it cannot share, but might have shared on earth, and turn to happiness." Again the spectre raised a cry and shook its chain and wrung its shadowy hands. "You are fettered," said Scrooge, trembling. "Tell me why." "I wear the chain I forged in life," replied the ghost. "I made it link by link and yard by yard. I girded it on of my own free will, and of my own free will I wore it. Is its pattern strange to you?" Scrooge trembled more and more. "Or would you know," pursued the ghost, "the weight and length of the strong coil you bear yourself? It was as full, as heavy, and as long as this several Christmas Eves ago. You have labored on it since. It is a ponderous chain." So the chain is made up of cash boxes and ledgers and other symbols of business, and it is a representation of his obligation to business, but his failure to satisfy the sympathetic requirements of a human participating in society. Marley, as part of his penance, has been required to warn Scrooge and help Scrooge avoid his fate. Like Marley, Scrooge has seen the cash nexus as his only relationship to other human beings and has neglected to help other people when he should have. And so, like Marley, Scrooge is going to be bound by these chains of his previous relationship with humans. And Marley's job is to help Scrooge avoid his fate.
"Oh, captive bound and double-ironed," cried the phantom, "not to know that ages of incessant labor by immortal creatures for this earth must pass into eternity before the good of which it is susceptible is all developed. Not to know that any Christian spirit working kindly in its little sphere, whatever it may be, will find its mortal life too short for the vast means of usefulness. Not to know that no space of regret can make amends for one's life's opportunities misused. Yet such was I. Oh, such was I." "But you were always a good man of business, Jacob," faltered Scrooge, who now began to apply this to himself. "Business!" cried the ghost, wringing its hands again. "Mankind was my business. The common welfare was my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, and benevolence were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business." It held up its chain at arm's length, as if that were the cause of all its unavailing grief, and flung it heavily upon the ground again. "At this time of the rolling year," the spectre said, "I suffer most. Why did I walk through crowds of fellow beings with my eyes turned down, and never raise them to that blessed star which led the wise men to a poor abode? Were there no poor homes to which its light would have conducted me?" And so the ghost offers him a means of redemption, which he says is no light part of my penance. In other words, part of his penance is to help Scrooge avoid his own fate. And the way he is going to avoid his fate is to be haunted by three spirits. As the ghost is leaving, Scrooge has a vision of all the other spirits who have failed to satisfy their human obligations. As Marley is floating backwards out the window, he looks out the window and sees the air was filled with phantoms, wandering hither and thither in restless haste and moaning as they went. Every one of them wore chains like Marley's ghost. Some few, they might have been guilty governments, were linked together. None were free. Many had been personally known to Scrooge in their lives. He had been quite familiar with one old ghost in a white waistcoat with a monstrous iron safe attached to its ankle, who cried piteously at being unable to assist a wretched woman with an infant who it saw below upon a doorstep. The misery with them all was clearly that they sought to interfere for good in human matters and had lost the power forever. So this establishes a couple of things. The first one is it tells us, again, reiterates what Scrooge's crime is, his cold, unsympathetic, selfish nature. But also it tells us something about the ghosts. The ghosts work by metaphor. They, in one form or another, realize or embody either the flaws that they're supposed to point out or the virtues they're supposed to teach. And so we need to look at them as allegorical representations of Scrooge's lessons. Scrooge's reformation takes place in three separate stages, each one represented by one of the ghosts that visits Scrooge. And so we want to pay attention to each ghost specifically to see what they allegorically represent. And the ghost of Christmas past, as the ghost tells Scrooge, is not historical past, but Scrooge's own past. And it speaks very specifically to something that Dickens believed in thoroughly, which is the importance of memory. In another of Scrooge's Christmas novels called The Haunted Man, the main character, Redlaw, is troubled by the memory of the fact that his beloved betrayed him and ran away with his best friend. He feels that this betrayal has caused him sadness, and so he wishes on Christmas Eve that he would be able to forget this memory that is so troubling him. And he gets his wish. He gets his wish of forgetting his sad past. And he also gets a bonus gift with purchase, which is that not only does he get to forget, but the people he meets also have this gift passed on to them, so they forget their own troubles and sad past. And what ends up happening as a result is that Redlaw himself and all of the people he meet start being unsympathetic and mean, that they start being uncaring to the people for whom they have cared and cruel to people. And finally, Redlaw, seeing this effect, wishes that he would be able to give up his gift. He doesn't want the gift anymore. Finally, he displays an act of sympathy. And when he displays an act of sympathy, in effect, an act of sympathy toward himself, the gift is canceled for himself and everyone else, and all the people go back to being nice. But the point is, and you should keep in mind Adam Smith at this particular point, as well as Percy Shelley in their discussion of the role of imagination, memory, and sympathy, that memory of one's own past suffering helps us sympathize with the sufferings and troubles of others. And so, for Scrooge, the Christmas spirit, which is a spirit of fellow feeling, is always bound up with both happy and sad memories. And we will see that represented allegorically in how the ghost of Christmas past is described. It was a strange figure, like a child, yet not so like a child as an old man, viewed through some supernatural medium, which gave him the appearance of having receded from the view and being diminished to a child's proportions. Its hair, which hung about its neck and down its back, was white as with age, and yet the face had not a wrinkle in it, and the tenderest bloom was on the skin. The arms were very long and muscular, and the hands the same, as if its hold were of uncommon strength. Its legs and feet, most delicately formed, were, like those upper members, bare. It wore a tunic of the purest white, and round its waist was bound a lustrous belt, the sheen of which was beautiful. It held a branch of fresh green holly in its hand, and in singular contradiction of that wintry emblem, had its dress trimmed with summer flowers. But the strangest thing about it was that from the crown of its head there sprung a bright, clear jet of light, by which all this was visible, and which was doubtless the occasion of its using, in its duller moments, a great extinguisher for a cap, which it now held under its arm. The ghost of Christmas past is like a child, childhood memory, yet it's also old. So it's both aged, it's been around for a while, but it's also a memory of a child. So memory of childhood. It's being diminished to a child's proportions. And I think Dickens here is trying to imagine how he sees himself as a child and how people see themselves as a child. They're sort of themselves projected backwards in time. So they're looking at themselves the way they are now, but seeing themselves in their childhood. So its hair was white with age, yet the face had not a wrinkle in it. The arms were very long and muscular, the hands the same, as if its hold were of uncommon strength. So memory has a strong hold. It's bare, it's open, it's exposed. The arms and legs are bare. It wore a tunic of the purest white, and it has a lustrous belt. It has a branch of fresh green holly in its hand. And remember, this is Christmas past, and so it's remembering past Christmases. But it has its dress trimmed with summer flowers, and you know, the confluence of memories. And from its head there sprung a bright, clear jet of white, which was doubtless the occasion of its using in its duller moments a great extinguisher for a cap, which it now held under its arm. An extinguisher is one of those things that they use to put out candles. It's that long conical thing on a handle that you use to put out candles. This extinguisher is a thing that one would use to extinguish or suppress memories. And later on, at the end of this chapter, Scrooge is going to attempt to force the extinguisher down over the ghost of Christmas past and suppress the memories which are troubling him. Even this, though, when Scrooge looked at it with increasing steadiness, was not its strangest quality. For as its belt sparkled and glittered now in one part and in another, what was light one instant at another time was dark. So the figure itself fluctuated in its distinctness, being now a thing with one arm, now with one leg, now with 20 legs, now a pair of legs without a head, now a head without a body, of which dissolving parts, no outline would be visible in the dense gloom wherein they melted away. And in the very wonder of this, it would be itself again, distinct and clear as ever. And of course, this is the metaphorical or allegorical representation of memory, which, like dreams, blends things together which are distinct, and then occasionally the things are very clear, and then occasionally they're all blended together, and sometimes you have memories of different part of your life which are blended in with memories of another part of your life and sort of indistinctness. Sometimes you forget things. So Dickens is offering in this image a memory of Scrooge's individual past looked at from the future. "Are you the spirit, sir, whose coming was foretold to me?" asked Scrooge. "I am." The voice was soft and gentle, singularly low, as if instead of being so close beside him, it were at a distance. Again, the voice of memory coming from a distance. "Who and what are you?" Scrooge demanded. "I am the ghost of Christmas past." "Long past?" inquired Scrooge, observant of its dwarfish stature. "No, your past." Perhaps Scrooge could not have told anybody why, if anybody would have asked him, but he had a special desire to see the spirit in his cap and begged him to be covered. Remember that his cap is the extinguisher, and Scrooge, for some reason he can't identify, is seeking to repress his memories, and we'll find out why later. "What?" exclaimed the ghost. "Would you so soon put out with worldly hands the light I give? Is it not enough that you are one of those whose passions made this cap, and forced me through whole trains of years to wear it low upon my brow?" Scrooge reverently disclaimed all intention to offend, or any knowledge of having willfully bonneted the spirit at any period in his life. He then made bold to inquire what business brought him here. "Your welfare," said the ghost. So the ghost is coming to improve Scrooge's welfare by helping him to remember his own past. The first place that the ghost takes Scrooge is back to his own childhood. As the words were spoken, they passed through the wall and stood upon an open country road with fields on either hand. The city had entirely vanished. Not a vestige of it was to be seen. The darkness and the mist had vanished with it, for it was a clear, cold winter day with snow upon the ground. "Good heavens," said Scrooge, clasping his hands together as he looked about him. "I was bred in this place. I was a boy here." The spirit gazed upon him mildly. Its gentle touch, though it had been light and instantaneous, appeared still present to the old man's sense of feeling. He was conscious of a thousand odors floating in the air, each connected with a thousand thoughts and hopes and joys and cares long, long forgotten. "Your lip is trembling," said the ghost. "And what is that upon your cheek?" And so this is the first symbol of what memory does to Scrooge. What it is upon his cheek, of course, is a tear. And as they're walking along the road, Scrooge sees people that he knows from his past as they are wishing each other Merry Christmas. The jocund travelers came on, and as they came, Scrooge knew and named them every one. Why was he rejoiced beyond all bounds to see them? Why did his cold eye glisten and his heart leap up as they went past? Why was he filled with gladness when he heard them give each other Merry Christmas as they parted at the crossroads and byways for their several homes? What was Merry Christmas to Scrooge? Out upon Merry Christmas! What good had it ever done him? "The school is not quite deserted," said the ghost. "A solitary child, neglected by his friends, is left there still." Scrooge said he knew it, and he sobbed. And so Scrooge is being taken back to long-suppressed memories in order to reawaken his memories of himself at that age, because the first stage in being able to feel pity for other people is to be able to feel pity for himself, and then be able to apply that pity imaginatively, remember Adam Smith, to other people's circumstances. On page 281, the ghost takes Scrooge into the school to see himself as a child. They went, the ghost and Scrooge, across the hall to a door at the back of the house. It opened before them and disclosed a long, bare, melancholy room, made barer still by the lines of plain deal forms and desks. One of these, a lonely boy, was reading near a feeble fire, and Scrooge sat down upon a form and wept to see his poor forgotten self as he used to be. So you'll notice immediately Scrooge is seeing himself as he used to be and weeping at his poor forgotten self. So this is clearly a sad memory which Scrooge has repressed to this point, and the spirit is reawakening this memory for him. And as a result of that, he starts to feel less evil and miserly. Not a latent echo in the house, not a squeak and scuffle from the mice behind the paneling, not a drip from the half-thawed waterspout in the dull yard behind, not a sigh among the leafless boughs of one despondent poplar, not the idle swinging of an empty storehouse door, no, not a clicking in the fire, but fell upon the heart of Scrooge with a softening influence and gave a freer passage to his tears. So it fell upon the heart of Scrooge with a softening influence and gave a freer passage to his tears. Scrooge's own memory makes him more sympathetic. So the first thing one has to do in order to become more sympathetic to others is become more sympathetic to oneself. Farther down the same page, Scrooge remembers how he felt as a boy and shifts from joy at his former pleasures to pity for his former sufferings. In pity for his former self, poor boy, and cried again. So he is able to reawaken his pity for himself. So Scrooge's unpleasant memories are awakening pity for his former self and causing him to change from his previously miserly and cold behavior. The change is immediately recorded on the next page, page 282, as Scrooge remembers a young man who had been singing Christmas carols at his door earlier in the day, and who he had threatened, but now wishes he'd given him something. "I wish," Scrooge muttered, putting his hand in his pocket and looking about him after drying his eyes with his cuff. "But it's too late now." "What is the matter?" asked the spirit. "Nothing," said Scrooge. "Nothing. There was a boy singing a Christmas carol at my door last night. I should like to have given him something, that's all." The ghost smiled thoughtfully. So once Scrooge is able to pity himself, he is better able to feel sympathy and pity for others. The next place the ghost takes him is to Fezziwig's, where he was apprenticed as a young man. And as I'm sure you know, a business education in those days meant working as an apprentice in the business. Fezziwig, unlike Scrooge, is a charitable, happy, friendly employer. And not only does he run a business, but he also takes good care of his apprentices, who are very grateful for the way they're treated. Unlike Scrooge, of course, who is very mean to Bob Cratchit and refuses to give him enough money to live on or to support his family on well, and doesn't even let him heat his office. And so the ghost implicitly calls attention to the contrast between Scrooge's behavior and his own employer, Fezziwig's. The spirit signed to him to listen to the two apprentices who were pouring out their hearts in praise of Fezziwig. And when he had done so, he said, "Why, is it not? He has spent but a few pounds of your mortal money, 3 or 4 perhaps. Is that so much that he deserves this praise?" "It isn't that," said Scrooge, heated by the remark and speaking unconsciously like his former, not his latter self. "It isn't that, spirit. He has the power to render us happy or unhappy, to make our service light or burdensome, a pleasure or a toil. Say that his power lies in words and looks, in things so slight and insignificant that it is impossible to add and count them up. What then? The happiness he gives is quite as great as if it cost a fortune." He felt the spirit's glance and stopped. "What is the matter?" asked the ghost. "Nothing particular," said Scrooge. "Something, I think," the ghost insisted. "No," said Scrooge. "No, I should like to be able to say a word or two to my clerk just now, that's all." So Scrooge's memory of himself as an apprentice to Fezziwig and his memory of how he was treated by Fezziwig now makes him sympathetic, or at least makes him pity his own clerk who is treated so poorly by himself. So the first stage in the reform accomplished by the Ghost of Christmas Past is to reawaken first Scrooge's own memories of his suffering, and then once he's able to pity himself, to turn his pity toward others like Bob Cratchit. In the last part of the stave, the ghost shows him the scene in which he broke up with his fiancée, or rather his fiancée broke up with him, because he has shifted his interest from her to making money, to the love of gain. Then shows what he has sacrificed by giving her up, because she's a poor dowerless girl who brings nothing to the marriage, in favor of the pursuit of wealth, because he shows her the family that she had that might have been his had he been wiser. And of course, the pain of this memory causes Scrooge to reject the memories and attempt to suppress them again by taking the extinguisher that the Ghost of Christmas Past has as a cap and trying to force it down over the memories and re-repress them. In the third stave, Scrooge is visited by the Ghost of Christmas Present. The Ghost of Christmas Present represents the Christmas spirit, the sense of pleasure and joy and fellowship. And what's interesting about the things that the ghost represents, the things with which the ghost is associated, is that they seem to represent, despite Dickens' attack on utilitarianism, basic, simple physical pleasures. The ghost seems to be, in fact, a Benthamite utilitarian, celebrating the simple pleasures of warmth, food, and good fellowship. In a sort of funny passage at the beginning of the stave, when Scrooge is expecting the ghost to show up and is decided that he is going to be absolutely ready for this ghost and not be frightened by him, we have this moment where Scrooge is expecting something but is surprised because instead of something, he gets nothing. "Gentlemen of the free and easy sort, who plume themselves on being acquainted with a move or two, and being usually equal to the time of day, express the wide range of their capacity for adventure by observing that they are good for anything from pitch and toss to manslaughter. So in other words, what that means is that gentlemen who think they're ready for anything and are usually equal to answer a question about what time it is, in other words, they're ready for everything, including everything from a simple child's game to murder, between which opposite extremes, no doubt, there lies a tolerably wide and comprehensive range of subjects. Without venturing for Scrooge quite as heartily as this, I don't mind calling on you to believe that he was ready for a good broad field of strange appearances, and that nothing between a baby and a rhinoceros would have astonished him very much. Now, being prepared for almost anything, he was not by any means prepared for nothing, and consequently, when the bell struck one, and no shape appeared, he was taken with a violent fit of trembling. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, a quarter of an hour went by, yet nothing came. All this time he lay upon his bed, the very core and center of a blaze of ruddy light, which streamed upon it when the clock proclaimed the hour, and which, being only light, was more alarming than a dozen ghosts, as he was powerless to make out what it meant or would be at, and was sometimes apprehensive that he might be, at that very moment, an interesting case of spontaneous combustion without having the consolation of knowing it. And so he finally discovers that this light is streaming under the door from the next room and decides that he is going to go into the room, and there he encounters the ghost of Christmas Present. Now, notice what the ghost of Christmas Present, once again, an allegorical representation of what he is supposed to teach Scrooge, is associated with. It was his own room. There was no doubt about that. But it had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and ceiling were so hung with living green that it looked a perfect grove, from every part of which bright gleaming berries glistened. The crisp leaves of holly, mistletoe, and ivy reflected back the light as if so many little mirrors had been scattered through, and such a mighty blaze went roaring up the chimney as that dull petrifaction of a hearth had never known in Scrooge's time or Marley's, or for many and many a winter season gone. Heaped up on the floor to form a kind of throne were turkeys, geese, game, poultry, brawn, great joints of meat, sucking pigs, long wreaths of sausages, mince pies, plum puddings, barrels of oysters, red-hot chestnuts, cherry-cheeked apples, juicy oranges, luscious pears, immense 12 cakes, and seething bowls of punch that made the chamber dim with their delicious steam. In easy state upon this couch there sat a jolly giant, glorious to see, who bore a glowing torch in the shape not unlike Plenty's horn, and held it high up to shed its light on Scrooge as he came peeping through the door. "Come in," exclaimed the ghost. "Come in and know me better, man." Scrooge entered timidly and hung his head before the spirit. He was not the dogged Scrooge he had been, and though its eyes were clear and kind, he did not like to meet them. "I am the ghost of Christmas Present," said the spirit. "Look upon me." Scrooge reverently did so. He was clothed in one simple deep green robe or mantle bordered with white fur. This garment hung so loosely on the figure that its capacious breast was bare, as if disdaining to be warded or concealed by any artifice. Its feet, observable beneath the ample folds of the garment, were also bare, and on its head it wore no other covering than a holly wreath set here and there with shining icicles. Its dark brown curls were long and free, free as its genial face, its sparkling eye, its open hand, its cheery voice, its unconstrained demeanor, and its joyful air. Girded round its middle was an antique scabbard, but no sword was in it, and the ancient sheath was eaten up with rust. "You have never seen the like of me before," exclaimed the spirit. "Never," Scrooge made answer to it. So the ghost of Christmas Present is associated with the simple joys and pleasures of Christmas, apparently having to do mostly with eating really good food and being friendly and open and unconstrained. On page 292, the ghost takes Scrooge out to walk among the people on Christmas Day, and though it's a gloomy day, the people are happy and cheerful. There was nothing very cheerful in the climate or the town, and yet there was an air of cheerfulness abroad that the clearest summer air and brightest summer sun might have endeavored to diffuse in vain. For the people who were shoveling away at the housetops were jovial and full of glee, calling out to one another from the parapets, and now and then exchanging a facetious snowball, better-natured missile far than many a wordy jest, laughing heartily if it went right, and not less heartily if it went wrong. The poulterers' shops were still half open, and the fruiterers were radiant in their glory. There were great round pot-bellied baskets of chestnuts, shaped like the waistcoats of jolly old gentlemen, lolling at the doors and tumbling out in the street in their apoplectic opulence.
There were ruddy, brown-faced, broad-girthed Spanish onions shining in the fitness of their growth like Spanish friars and winking from their shelves in wanton slyness as the girls that they went by and glanced demurely at the hung-up mistletoe. There were pears and apples clustered high in blooming pyramids. There were bunches of grapes made in the shopkeeper's malevolence to dangle from conspicuous hooks that people's mouths might water gratis as they passed. There were piles of filberts, mossy and brown, recalling in their fragrance ancient walks among the woods, and pleasant shufflings ankle-deep through withered leaves. There were Norfolk biffins, suave and swarthy, setting off the yellow of the oranges and lemons, and in the great compactness of their juicy persons, urgently entreating and beseeching to be carried home in paper bags and eaten after dinner. The very gold and silver fish set forth among these choice fruits in a bowl, though members of a dull and stagnant-blooded race, appeared to know that there was something going on, and to a fish went gasping round and round their little world in slow and passionless excitement. The grocers, oh, the grocers, nearly closed, with perhaps two shutters down, or one, but through those gaps such glimpses. It was not alone that the scales descending on the counter made a merry sound, or that the twine and roller parted company so briskly, or that the canisters were rattled up and down like juggling tricks, or even that the blended scents of tea and coffee were so grateful to the nose, or even that the raisins were so plentiful and rare, the almonds so extremely white, the sticks of cinnamon so long and straight, the other spices so delicious, the candied fruits so caked and spotted with molten sugar as to make the coldest lookers-on feel faint and subsequently bilious. Nor was it that the figs were moist and pulpy, or that the French plums blushed in modest tartness from the highly decorated boxes, or that everything was good to eat and in its Christmas dress. But the customers were all so hurried and so eager in the hopeful promise of the day that they tumbled up against each other at the door, crashing their wicker baskets wildly, and left their purchases upon the counter and came running back to fetch them, and committed hundreds of like mistakes in the best humor possible, while the grocer and his people were so frank and fresh that the polished hearts with which they fastened their aprons behind might have been their own, worn outside for general inspection, and for Christmas daws to peck at if they choose. It's worth taking a moment to go through this passage and look at it in some detail in order to understand what kinds of characteristics, what kinds of personality characteristics and attitudes that Dickens associates with Christmas. And there are three different kinds of things associated with Christmas here. The first one has to do with the characteristics that are specifically associated with humans. The second one has to do with the human characteristics that are imbued upon the groceries and various objects in the scene as they are personified. And the third one has to do with behaviors that are evoked in connection with the objects he describes. So the first one has to do with people themselves. The people themselves are jovial and full of glee. They're exchanging facetious snowballs in jest, which are better natured than the wordy jest they exchange, and then laughing heartily. So there's plenty of laughter and hopefulness going on. The fruits also are associated with similar kinds of characteristics. The pot-bellied baskets of chestnuts are shaped like the waistcoats of jolly old gentlemen lolling at the doors. There are ruddy, brown-faced, broad-girthed Spanish onions that are associated with friars. So you get the impression of jolly Spanish friars in their brown Franciscan garments, winking in wanton slyness at girls as they go by. And the girls themselves are glancing demurely at the hung-up mistletoe, obviously thinking about getting a kiss under the mistletoe. And then the third category has to do with the memories that are evoked. And remember that memories, as we saw in the previous stave, are a very important part of Christmas. He says that the piles of filberts, mossy and brown, recalling in their fragrance ancient walks among the woods and pleasant shuffling ankle-deep through withered leaves. So he's got three different kinds of characteristics that are being embodied here. On the next page, we have a similar set of associations. We have the people who are committing hundreds of the like mistakes in the best humor possible. And the grocer and his people are frank and fresh. And they wear their hearts on their aprons. And at the same time, we have the goods descending on the counter with a merry sound.
So clearly, according to Dickens, through the associated characteristics of Christmas in this scene, Christmas is associated with good humor and jolliness and plenty and memories of past experiences in Christmas, and especially with simple pleasure. So the spirit of Christmas present seems to be associated with the pleasures of good food, jolly behavior, and good company. Next, the ghost takes Scrooge to the Cratchits, so he gets to see a poor, though happy, family on Christmas Day, and how, despite their poverty, they still manage to maintain the Christmas spirit, supporting each other, showing love for each other. And at the Cratchits, of course, as everyone certainly knows, Scrooge gets to meet for the first time Cratchit's young child, Tiny Tim, who is ill in some undefined way but walks with a crutch and nevertheless is a happy, cheerful young boy. And if we move down to page 297, we get to see Scrooge's sympathy engage with Tiny Tim. "Spirit," said Scrooge with an interest he had never felt before, "tell me if Tiny Tim will live." "I see a vacant seat," replied the ghost, "in a poor chimney corner, and a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die." "No, no," said Scrooge. "Oh, no, kind spirit, say he will be spared." "If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, none other of my race," returned the ghost, "will find him here. What then? If he be like to die, he had better do it and decrease the surplus population." Scrooge hung his head to hear his own words quoted by the spirit and was overcome with penitence and grief. "Man," said the ghost, "if man you be in heart, not adamant, forbear that wicked cant until you discovered what the surplus is and where it is. Will you decide what men shall live and what men shall die? It may be that in the sight of heaven you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this poor man's child. Oh God, to hear the insect on the leaf pronouncing on the too much life among his hungry brothers in the dust." Scrooge bent before the ghost rebuke and trembling cast his eyes upon the ground. And then, of course, Bob Cratchit offers a toast to Mr. Scrooge, the founder of his feast, which Mrs. Cratchit does not accept, describing Scrooge as an odious, stingy, hard, unfeeling man. And Scrooge understands how he is regarded by other people. The ghost then takes Scrooge to visit Fred and his wife so Scrooge can understand what pleasures and fellowship he's missing out on. And then finally, at the end of the chapter, on page 304, Dickens has the ghost of Christmas present offer a little homily on the social cost of ignorance and want. The purpose of this speech is to warn his audience that not only does Scrooge himself, and by extension anyone who practices Scrooge behavior, suffer from this failure to take care of those who are in poverty and ignorance, but also that they threaten the very stability of society itself. In fact, although once again Dickens imagines himself to be anti-utilitarian, he's very much appealing to the self-interest of his audience, who, he says, if they fail to take care of the poor, are likely to suffer from the social unrest, disruption, and potential revolution that those poor may promote if they're not properly taken care of. On page 304, Scrooge starts out saying, "Forgive me if I'm not justified in what I ask," said Scrooge, looking intently at the spirit's robe, "but I see something strange, not belonging to yourself, protruding from under your skirts. Is it a foot or claw?" "It might be a claw, for the flesh there is upon it," was the spirit's sorrowful reply. "Look here." From the folding of its robe it brought forth two children, wretched, abject, frightful, hideous, miserable. They knelt down at its feet and clung upon the outside of its garment. "Oh, man, look here, look, look, down here," exclaimed the ghost. They were a boy and a girl, yellow, meager, ragged, scowling, wolfish, but prostrate, too, in their humility. Where graceful youth should have filled their features out and touched them with its freshest tints, a stale and shriveled hand like that of age had pinched and twisted them and pulled them to shreds. Where angels might have sat enthroned, devils lurked and glared out menacing. No change, no degradation, no perversion of humanity in any grade through all the mysteries of wonderful creation has monsters half so horrible and dread. Scrooge started back, appalled. Having shown them to him in this way, he tried to say they were fine children, but the words choked themselves rather than be parties to a lie of such enormous magnitude. Spirit, are they yours? Scrooge said, say no more. They are man's, said the spirit, looking down upon them. And they cling to me, appealing from their fathers. This boy is ignorance. This girl is want. Beware them both in all of their degree, but most of all beware this boy. For on his brow I see that written which is doom. Unless the writing be erased. Deny it, cried the spirit, stretching out its hand toward the city. Slander those who tell it ye. Admit it for your factious purposes, and make it worse, and bide the end. Have they no refuge or resource? Cried Scrooge. Are there no prisons? Said the spirit, turning on him for the last time with his own words. Are there no workhouses? The bell struck 12. And then, at the end of the chapter, we see the final spirit, the ghost of Christmas yet to come,
emerge from the darkness.
As the last stroke ceased to vibrate, he remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting up his eyes, beheld a solemn phantom, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground towards him. The ghost of Christmas yet to come is very different from the previous three ghosts, although identical in the sense that it is an allegorical representation of what it needs to teach Scrooge. The ghost of Christmas yet to come represents the future. It's the eyes of the future looking back on Scrooge. And the future can look back on us and see us. We can be seen from the future, but we can't see to the future. So Scrooge is unable to see the ghost. He knows he's there. He's a black shape, but unable to make out any features or details of the ghost, as he is unable to make out any features or details of the future. And yet the ghost is able to see him, and Scrooge has the sense of the eyes watching him carefully. The phantom slowly, gravely, silently approached. When it came near him, Scrooge bent down upon his knee, for in the very air through which this spirit moved, it seemed to scatter gloom and mystery. It was shrouded in a deep black garment which concealed its head, its face, its form, and left nothing of it visible save one outstretched hand. But for this it would have been difficult to detach its figure from the night and separate it from the darkness by which it was surrounded. He felt that it was tall and stately when it came beside him, and that its mysterious presence filled him with a solemn dread. He knew no more, for the spirit neither spoke nor moved. So the ghost is unseeable, except that we know it's there and it directs us to the future. Except for its one outstretched hand, it would have been difficult to detach its figure from the night and separate it from the darkness by which it was surrounded. It's tall and stately, and it fills him with a solemn dread, but it doesn't speak. "I am in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come," said Scrooge. The spirit answered not, but pointed onward with its hand. "You are about to show me shadows of things that have not happened, but will happen in the time before us," Scrooge pursued. "Is that so, spirit?" The upper portion of the garment was contracted for an instant in its folds, as if the spirit had inclined its head. That was the only answer that he received. Although well used to ghostly company by this time, Scrooge feared the silent shape so much that his legs trembled beneath him, and he found that he could hardly stand when he prepared to follow it. The spirit paused a moment, as observing his condition and giving him time to recover. But Scrooge was all the worse for this. It thrilled him with a vague, uncertain horror to know that behind the dusky shroud there were ghostly eyes, intently fixed upon him, while he, though he stretched his own to the utmost, could see nothing but a spectral hand and one great heap of black. "Ghost of the future," he exclaimed, "I fear you more than any specter I have seen." So, of course, the future doesn't speak to us. We can't see it. We can't talk to it. But it can see us, because the future can look back upon us and know what we have done. The future knows us, but we don't know it. On page 306, the ghost of Christmas yet to come takes Scrooge to the exchange.
or the change, as it's familiarly called. The exchange is the equivalent of Wall Street. It's a commodity trading location. It's the place where commodity traders meet to buy and sell goods. And Scrooge is a speculator in commodities. That's what he does. And also a money lender, as we'll find out later. When they're at the exchange, Scrooge witnesses a conversation between a group of people that Scrooge knows and with whom he has done business, and they are talking about the funeral of someone who has died, whom they call Old Scratch. And Scrooge doesn't know who it is. Of course, we know it's Scrooge himself. Scrooge is apparently willfully repressing the recognition of his own death. But what characterizes this speech of people whom Scrooge knows very well is that they make very light of the death and ultimately make a joke of it. "No," said a great fat man with a monstrous chin. "I don't know much about it either way. I only know that he's dead." "When did he die?" inquired another. "Last night, I believe." "Why, what was the matter with him?" asked a third, taking a vast quantity of snuff out of a very large snuff box. "I thought he'd never die." "God knows," said the first, with a yawn. So clearly they're not terribly concerned about the death of this man. "What has he done with his money?" asked a red-faced gentleman with a pendulous excrescence on the end of his nose that shook like gills of a turkey cock. "I haven't heard," said the man with the large chin, yawning again. "Left it to his company, perhaps." "He hasn't left it to me, that's all I know." This pleasantry was received with a general laugh. "It's likely to be a very cheap funeral," said the same speaker, "for upon my life I don't know of anybody to go to it. Suppose we make up a party and volunteer." "I don't mind going if a lunch is provided," observed a gentleman with the excrescence on his nose, "but I must be fed if I make one." Another laugh. "Well, I am the most disinterested among you after all," said the first speaker, "for I never wear black gloves and I never eat lunch, but I'll offer to go if anybody else will. When I come to think of it, I'm not at all sure that I wasn't his most particular friend, for we used to stop and speak whenever we met. Bye-bye." Speakers and listeners strolled away and mixed with other groups. Scrooge knew the men and looked toward the spirit for an explanation. Of course, these men are discussing Scrooge's death and making a joke of it because they have no particular connection with Scrooge. Of course, during these conversations, as Scrooge is witnessing people talk about the death that he refuses to recognize as his own, the ghost is watching him. He fancied from the turn of the hand and its situation in reference to himself that the unseen eyes are looking at him keenly. It made him shudder and feel very cold. At the bottom of page 307 and on 308 and 309, Scrooge witnesses a group of people in essentially what works out to be the equivalent of a pawn shop selling goods that they have apparently stolen from the chambers of a dead man. They are the maid, the charwoman, and the nurse who cared for the dead man. And they're selling the sheets off his bed, the curtains and rings from his bed, his personal effects that were left in the room, and even the clothes that they put on the dead body to be buried in because they were too fine and expensive to be buried in the ground and instead put cheaper clothes on him and took the clothes away. Scrooge is appropriately horrified by their deep lack of concern or awareness of death or their reverence for the dead body. But Mrs. Dilber, the laundress, says, "If he wanted to keep them after he was dead, wicked old screw," pursued the woman, "why wasn't he natural in his lifetime? If he had been, he'd have somebody to look after him when he was struck with death, instead of lying gasping out his last there, alone by himself." So clearly, the dead man, who we know to be Scrooge, although Scrooge refuses to recognize it, is being so regarded because he has not formed any attachments with other human beings during his life. And so in the future, he will be forgotten. At the bottom of page 309, this is the end of it, you see. "He frightened everyone away from him when he was alive to profit us when he was dead." Now Scrooge, horrified by this lack of emotion and reverence for death, demands that the ghost take him to see some tender emotion at the man's death. On the next page, page 310, the narrator intrudes and gives us a homily conveying the lesson that Scrooge and we are supposed to learn about the effects in the future of Scrooge's lack of companionship and fellowship in the present. "Oh, cold, cold, rigid death, set up thine altar here and dress it with such terrors as thou hast at thy command, for this is thy dominion.
but of the love revered and honored head thou canst not turn one hair to the dread purposes, or make one feature odious. It is not that the hand is heavy and will fall down when released. It is not that the heart and pulse are still, but that the hand was open, generous and true, the heart brave, warm and tender, and the pulse a man's. Strike, shadow, strike, and see his good deeds springing from the wound to sow the world with life immortal. No voice pronounced these words in Scrooge's ears, and yet he heard them when he looked upon the bed. He thought, if this man could be raised up now, what would be his foremost thoughts? Avarice, hard-dealing, griping cares? They have brought him to a rich end, truly. He lay in the dark, empty house, with not a man, woman, or child to say he was kind to me in this or that. Or from the memory of one kind word, I will be kind to him. A cat was tearing at the door, and there was the sound of gnawing rats beneath the hearthstone. What they wanted in the room of death, and why they were so restless and disturbed, Scrooge did not dare to think.
I just want to point out what a secular notion of the future this is, as opposed to a religious one. One is not being told to be good because one will get a reward in heaven in the afterlife, but rather one should be a good person because they will live on in the memories of others. It's very similar to the pagan notion of the afterlife exemplified in something like Beowulf.
Now the ghost wants Scrooge to uncover the head, obviously to reveal Scrooge's own dead body, but Scrooge refuses to do that. Instead, having witnessed all of the insensitivity, lack of care, and lack of reverence for this man's death as a result of his selfish and miserly behavior, Scrooge demands of the ghost to show him some tender emotion in response to this man's death. He wants to see that someone cares. And he does get a tender emotion, but ironically, it's a tender emotion not because he has died, but because he is dead. Farther down the page, he says, "Is there any person in town who feels emotion caused by this man's death?" said Scrooge, quite agonized. "Show that person to me, spirit, I beseech you." So he finds a young woman waiting for a young man, apparently her husband, to come home, and the young husband had gone to Scrooge to beg Scrooge's forbearance on collecting a loan, because apparently Scrooge had made a loan to this couple, and the loan had come due, and they didn't have the money to pay it, and Scrooge was about to foreclose on them on Christmas and take away their home and have them thrown out. And the happy emotion that they have is the result of hearing that Scrooge has died and so that he won't be able to foreclose on them. "Is it good," she said, "or bad to help him?" "Bad," he answered. "We are quite ruined?" "No, there is hope yet, Carolyn." "If he relents," she said, amazed, "there is. Nothing is past hope if such a miracle has happened." "He is past relenting," said her husband. "He is dead." She was a mild and patient creature if her face spoke truth. But she was thankful in her soul to hear it, and she said so with clasped hands. She prayed forgiveness the next moment and was sorry, but the first was the emotion of her heart. So the emotion that someone feels as a result of this unnamed man's death is relief that he won't be able to torture them. "I don't know, but before that time we shall be ready with the money, and even though we were not, it would be bad fortune indeed to find so merciless a creditor and his successor. We may sleep tonight with light hearts, Carolyn." Yes, soften it as they would, their hearts were lighter. The children's faces, hushed and clustered around to hear what they so little understood, were lighter, and it was a happier house for this man's death. The only emotion the ghost could show him caused by the event was one of pleasure. So finally Scrooge demands, "Let me see some tenderness connected with a death, any death." And of course, the ghost takes him to the Cratchit's house, where they are mourning the death of Tiny Tim. And finally, the ghost takes him to a grave and demands that Scrooge uncover the name of the person buried in this forgotten grave that's not been tended by anyone. And Scrooge finally discovers the so long delayed knowledge that the dead man who no one cares about is he himself. And of course, in stave 5, the end of it, Scrooge reforms. But his reform is a very interesting kind. Scrooge's reform is a purely utilitarian one. Scrooge decides that he is going to pay Bob Cratchit better. He is going to help Bob Cratchit in any way possible, including helping Tiny Tim get care. And he is going to spread kindness and cheer to everyone he meets. And so finally, despite Dickens' expressed intent, Scrooge actually becomes a sort of utilitarian hero.
Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all and infinitely more. And to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he was a second father. He became as good a friend, as good a master, and as good a man as the good old city knew, or any other good old city, town, or borough in the good old world. Some people laughed to see the alteration in him, but he let them laugh and little heeded them, for he was wise enough to know that nothing ever happened on this globe for good, at which some people did not have their fill of laughter in the outset. And knowing that such as these would be blind anyway, he thought it quite as well that they should wrinkle up their eyes and grin as have the malady in less attractive forms. His own heart laughed, and that was quite enough for him. He had no further intercourse with spirits, but lived upon the total abstinence principle ever afterwards. And it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well, if any man alive possessed the knowledge. May that be truly said of us, and all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us, everyone. So the point of this discussion has been to describe the way that Dickens, even though he is explicitly attacking what he thinks is utilitarianism in the person of Scrooge, ends up proposing a doctrine, a philosophy of living, which is extremely similar to the one that John Stuart Mill outlined in his pamphlet Utilitarianism, one in which the golden rule of Jesus of Nazareth, love thy neighbor as thyself, is the doctrine for behavior. Ultimately, even though Dickens sees himself as a follower of Carlyle, a transcendentalist, and an opponent of the philosophical radicals and utilitarians, he nevertheless ultimately imposes a utilitarian standard of behavior and belief. Acts are judged according to whether or not they produce pleasure or mitigate pain. The other topic that I want to introduce is something that will become essential in our next text, which is Jane Eyre, and that is the doctrine of surveillance, because an important element in Scrooge's reform is the knowledge that he is always being watched by the future. The ghost that he cannot himself see can always see him and will always judge his behavior. And that idea of surveillance, which we discussed when we looked at Jeremy Bentham's notion of the panopticon, becomes the essential notion in the world that Jane Eyre herself occupies. And it becomes the essential tool that Jane uses in order to gain some control over her world.